Hello all, I am the One Nerd, and I want to welcome you to another edition of the One Nerd Reviews. Well, it's that time of year again. Actually, it was that time of year a few weeks ago. Look, I'll be completely honest with you guys. I planned this review to come out a while ago, but then the cinema snob came out with his version of the review for this movie, and I really had to do a complete overhaul to make sure that it was the best that it could possibly be. Not that I could say that I could ever live up to the cinema snob, but I had to at least try. And I hope that I was able to accomplish that to at least make a not necessarily a better review, but a different review than what he did. But getting back to the point, we're going to be looking at one of the newest sequels to one of my favorite slasher movies of all time, Halloween, which is called Halloween.
Testing 1, 2, 3. We're on.
We're here to investigate a patient that killed 3 innocent teenagers on a Halloween in 1978. He was shot by his own psychiatrist and taken into custody that night, and has spent the last 40 years in captivity. Hello, Michael.
Halloween, just Halloween, was released in 2018 from our good friends at Blumhouse, who are mostly known for their ever-degrading Purge series and the upcoming remake of a remake of Black Christmas. And not to get too off-topic right off the bat, but I just have to point out how bad the poster is for that movie. I mean, if you look at it, it looks like a straight-to-DVD sequel for the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants or something. I mean, the only thing to inform you that it's a horror movie is that little axe thing, and the only thing to inform you that it's a Christmas movie are those lights. And Slay Girl? I mean, that's a pun for a romantic comedy set at Christmas. And another thing, much like the 2009 Star Trek movie, this is a reboot slash remake. In the universe of this movie, only the original Halloween happened, none of the other sequels. Which sucks because it does mean that Halloween 2 didn't exist, or at least it's in a separate timeline, a separate universe. But on the other hand, it also means that we can pretend that this never happened.
Trick or treat, motherfucker!
So, you know, you take the good with the bad. At the end of the original Halloween, Michael Myers' rampage was ended by Dr. Loomis and his gun. But before Dr. Loomis and Laurie can feel too safe, they discover Michael has survived and escaped. Now, in the OG timeline, we would just move right into Halloween 2 and continue the night that he came home. But for this movie, apparently, Michael got up and disappeared and was just picked up by the cops at some point. It makes sense that he would be in a weakened state, but it's never explained to the movie exactly how they got him. I assume he just stumbled back to the mental hospital that he escaped from and just collapsed in a bloody mess. We open the film with two reporters who are, for some reason, doing a story of some kind on Michael Myers. I get that true crime podcasts are, like, really big nowadays, but you gotta imagine that after 40 years, the wells pretty much ran dry on the whole masked killer thing. The two enter the facility to see Michael, and they are greeted by Dr. Sartan, a former student of Dr. Loomis, who has taken over studying Michael after his death. The doctor leads them to where Michael is, and Aaron tries to get a reaction out of Michael.
I borrowed something from a friend at the Attorney General's office, Michael. You feel it, don't you, Michael? Say something!
Say something!
I really like this opening scene. It's very tense, it has a great amount of buildup, and it presents Michael, or the shape, as more of a presence than an actual person. The person, Michael Myers, is not important here. It's the entity that resides in him, the shape, that is making itself known, and it's felt by everyone. Except not really, but we'll get to that. Aaron also seems really invested in this for some reason. He took the time to get the original mask and is pushing really hard to get a reaction out of Michael. This would lead you to believe that he has more of a stake in this case than, you know, just researching it for a podcast or something. After the opening credits, the two podcasters track down the other side of the coin in the Michael Myers case, that being Laurie Strode. It seems in the 40 years since the first film, she has become a hermit.
You might need this.
Dana, journalists don't pay for their interviews.
First of all, you're a podcaster, okay? Let's not go nuts on the whole labels and all that. And second of all, yes, they do. They absolutely do. The two try to convince Lori to do an interview for their podcast.
If you have a moment, we've traveled a very long way.
How does $3,000 sound?
I assume this was the screenwriter's attempt to adapt the actual conversation that they had with Jamie Lee Curtis on coming back for another Halloween movie. Bold choice, very original. Lori lets them in, and the two attempt to get more info on the night he came home.
I believe there's a lot to learn from the horrors you experienced.
There's nothing to learn. There are no new insights or discoveries.
Really seems like the writers were trying to send a message here to not expect anything out of this movie. Again, they basically say in the movie, there's no new insights. There's nothing new to say about this. And they are correct.
So is he real?
Who?
The boogeyman.
You don't believe in the boogeyman?
I believe in Michael Myers, a deranged serial killer, but the boogeyman, no.
Then what the fuck was this?
Say something.
You can feel it, can't you? It's a part of you.
Say something, Michael.
You were there. You saw that. You were right in the middle of it. You can't have a character so heavily invested in this case, but then be skeptical about what's really going on and what's right in front of his eyes and what this whole thing really means. One thing that is useful about opening with podcasters is that we can have a big ol' exposition dump.
Two failed marriages. Rocky relationship with your daughter and granddaughter.
Michael Myers murdered 5 people, and he's a human being we need to understand.
It's good to know, at least in this timeline, that Ben Tramer more than likely survived and they did get together for a bit.
We met with Michael. I showed him the mask. It was nothing. No response, nothing.
No response. Aaron recommends that maybe after all these years, the clearly traumatized and paranoid woman could be cured by simply sitting down and talking to Michael. And he says this sincerely. These two characters were written just as a lazy excuse for exposition. And, of course, to remind the audience what happened in the first movie. They're pretty much underwritten and pointless otherwise. I mean, there are two of them, but they gave both character traits of being skeptical and invested to one of them. If you have two views on the story, maybe give one to each. Dana, the girl one, has nothing to do in the movie except get killed. Why not give them a Mulder and Scully sort of thing? Aaron is a jaded pro who is just looking for a story. He picked up the case at random and decided to follow up on it, while Dana is more invested in the human side of it. She tries to relate to Lori and get her to open up, but is shut down. Giving these two actually consistent personalities rather than making them blank exposition machines might actually make me care a little bit more about them when they eventually get killed. Now that they have been established, we cut to Laurie Strode's daughter and her granddaughter, Allison. Laurie's daughter is played by Judy Greer of Archer fame.
You're not my supervisor!
And her husband is played by The Wiz.
Yes, I'm The Wiz! I'm The Wiz!
In even more clumsy and blunt exposition, we find out that Lori's granddaughter is a good student with a bright future, and it would be a shame if a mass killer ever came after her.
Did you invite grandmother like you said you would?
I'm sorry, excuse me?
She needs cognitive behavioral therapy.
No one talks like this. You had 3 screenwriters, and this was the best way that you could come up with to convey this information to us? Speaking of awkward exposition dumps, we meet some of Allison's friends on her way to school.
She just tries to keep me away from her. Everyone in my family, like, turns into a total nutcase this time of year.
Does your grandma ever talk about it?
Yeah, it's pretty much all she talks about. She's been traumatized ever since.
Wasn't it her brother?
I mean, obviously she would be going over all of this information again in detail. I mean, she's obviously talking to just 2 random people she just met on the street and not longtime friends. The movie is mostly exposition at this point to explain what happened in the last 40 years in the most lazy way possible. If only there was a sequel set directly after the first one that could have wrapped up the story with the same people so we didn't have to spend half the movie on explanations. If only.
Let's get butchered by some random crazy person.
Is it though? Because all things considered, there's a lot worse stuff that's happening today and like, I mean, what, a couple people getting killed by one guy with a knife is not that big of a deal.
Oh man, that guy really sucks. I mean, I hate him. He's so unrealistically mean and dumb and stupid. I sure hope he gets his comeuppance sometime later on during the movie. Just again, to remind her that this was three screenwriters that wrote this, and they had no issue with that whole exchange. A jump scare introduces us to two more terrible male figures in the form of Allison's boyfriend, Cameron, and his creepy, nice guy friend, Oscar. I feel personally insulted by the Oscar character because I see so much of my high school self in him. I really, really hate myself. Before reminding us all that the screenwriters have in fact watched the first movie, I sure wish I was, Lori and Allison talk about her future.
I'll save it for college then.
Fuck college. Go somewhere. Go to Mexico.
You can really tell that Lori has really been isolated when she thinks that the most exotic place that a teen can go is Mexico.
She's a freak. But she'll get over it.
Why can't you? The boogeyman? All this hiding, all this preparation, it was for nothing. I mean, it took priority over your family. It cost you your family.
Man, she's gonna feel really stupid in the next few hours. Lori prepares a bit more before staking out Michael's transfer to make sure he gets on the bus. This is a point that I kind of breeze past through at the beginning, but how is Lori able to afford all this? She has a pretty awesome prepper setup. Big fence, cameras, speaker system, a trapdoor, kitchen island, a clearly bloated mannequin budget, and racks of guns. And believe me, no woman with PTSD and clear mental problems is getting that many guns without having to get it shadily on the black market or through, you know, personal connections or something. You gotta pay a lot more to go through those channels. So how is she paying for all this? It's implied that maybe, just like the podcaster, she takes money to talk about her story, but you would have to assume if she got paid so much that she could afford all of this, there would be literally nothing more to say. It's quite possible that the two divorces paid out well, but, you know, usually when you're crazy enough to have your kid taken away from you, you don't get those checks every month anymore. Getting back to the scene, Lori has been preparing for this moment since Michael was put away, and she is gonna make sure that he gets to the high security facility.
It ran late, I'm sorry.
Hey, Mom.
That's mine.
I thought you quit drinking. Mm. Mom, what are you doing?
What are you doing? This has been your life for decades. You've been preparing for this. You lost your daughter and your granddaughter over this. The least you can do is see it through to the end and confirm it. But yeah, you know, he was just on a bus with no police escort whatsoever for a high profile murderer, crazy person like this. I mean, what's the worst that could happen? That gay kid's death is on your hands, Lori. He could have been the next Baryshnikov. Back with the podcasters, they head to the site of Judith Meyer's grave to give even more exposition, this time on things we already know.
As she sat combing her hair, unaware, her six-year-old brother crept in quietly with a kitchen knife.
He then proceeded to slice the base of her skull, scraping her spinal cord.
What? Excuse me, what? That's not what happened. Seriously, this really bugged me when watching the movie. There's no indication whatsoever that Michael started stabbing his sister in the back. In fact, they actually show the clip in this scene of that happening, and it's clear that that does not happen. I get that they, you know, weren't actually there and they weren't able to see everything. I mean, there's a line how, you know, she was brushing her hair. I mean, they would have no idea of knowing that, but they would have seen the police reports and the autopsy reports to know that there was a brush there, so she's probably brushing her hair, and they know exactly where she was stabbed. And nowhere in the original film or in the clip that they showed did he get stabbed in the back or in the, you know, spinal cord or any of that. All in the front. And it happened after she saw Michael. She saw Michael. She reacted. Stab, 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 stab. That's what happened. This is so weird. I'm not sure if this was an intentional screw-up, but it leads to nothing. And again, it's just another one of those things that just leads me to believe that the people who made this movie don't actually know anything about Halloween. I mean, they know the bare bones of it. They know about Michael, they know about Lori, they know about all the moments that happen. Oh, we'll get to the moments that they know happened in this movie. But they don't actually know it, which is weird that you would have people in charge of doing a sequel 40 years after the original who don't know anything about the original. Michael overhears them at the cemetery and confronts them to set the record straight. Damn fake news. Get my story right at least. After clearing his good name, Michael retrieves his mask for a nice trailer shot. I mean, this looked like a fairly, you know, open gas station. I feel like somebody driving by in the middle of the day would have noticed a very large individual putting on a very spooky mask. The news breaks that the bus carrying Michael has crashed. Yeah, I bet you wish now that you had actually confirmed the person you've been obsessing over for 40 years was actually put away! Lori gets suited up and goes to warn her daughter in the most impractical way possible.
What? Gotcha!
Jesus.
You're dead.
You scared me! What are you doing in our house?
You mean, how did I get into your house?
You have no security system, Karen. Your side window is wide open.
Sometimes I can't tell the difference between your stupidity and your ignorance.
Say Michael escaped.
The bus crashed.
What?
Look, I have a plan. Where's Allison? We need to get out of here now.
What bus crashed?
Tell them Michael escaped.
You need help, and you are not welcome in this house until you get it.
I have tried to protect you and prepare you. Now we have to hunt him down.
Yeah, and I am trying to prepare dinner for my family.
Tell them Michael Myers is on the loose, you stupid bitch! I mean, it's not that hard to show them the fact that Michael Myers is escaped. Again, he's high profile. The bus crash is being reported on the news. Do you really want to protect your family here, Lori? Because you're not doing a very good job at it. Meanwhile, the cops are hot on the trail of Michael. They know it's him, they know what he's capable of, and they know that he needs to be stopped.
I was there. We have one order of business. That's to hunt this thing down.
Cut immediately to later that night, where children are trick-or-treating in the open like nothing is going on. What the hell is wrong with this movie and this movie's universe? It's not like Michael Myers' escape is a mystery. Clearly, everyone knows about it. The cops know about it. The local government clearly knows about it. Everyone knows about this. There wasn't even a scene, you know, appealing to the mayor or anything that says, oh, we gotta close down the streets. We gotta stop the trick-or-treaters. And the mayor's like, oh, we can't stop the trick-or-treaters. You know, this is the biggest candy-getting time of the year. Those kids depend on this candy for the rest of the year. And there's nothing like that. No effort whatsoever was put into explaining any of what's going on here. These are just a series of scenes that are happening with no connecting fiber to any of this. Three screenwriters! Michael makes his way around the neighborhood in a really great sequence. As much crap as I give this movie, I do acknowledge when it does good. And these shots here, this whole sequence, which was used for pretty much every single trailer, which makes sense because you use the best scenes to sell the movie, and this really was one of the best scenes, is really well done and does have a lot of tension and build up to it. We even get a nice moment of, will Michael kill the baby? But as we know from the other remake, Michael doesn't kill babies. Meanwhile, at the high school's Halloween dance, which is also for some reason going on despite Michael Myers being on the loose. Seriously, what are the police and Lori doing this entire time this is going on? Allison and her boyfriend and Mr. Nice Guy all party down. Allison and her BF are dressed as Bonnie and Clyde, but the twist is that they're swapped. Now, seriously, like earlier in the movie, like this is treated as like some sort of mind-blowing secret that they're keeping from their parents. At the dance, Allison gets calls from her friend Vicky, who is babysitting for the night.
I know you're talking about smoking weed. Don't lie to me. That's against the rules. I'm telling my mom.
Well, I'm going to tell your mom about your browser history.
You better not.
God, I'll talk about this kid later. We see more of the dance, and Allison's boyfriend is for some reason cheating on her. In a public place, in front of their classmates, in a small dance hall that he knows his girlfriend is also in. Not even, like, behind a pillar or something. No effort. Just out and about. This also comes out of absolutely nowhere. He proceeds to try to confront her and ends up dunking her phone in cheese dip. For some fucking reason. You might think this may lead to another fight. Maybe he will get his comeuppance later from Michael, or he can redeem himself by saving Allison. He's never seen in the movie again. We see Lori driving around some random street, apparently looking for Michael. She apparently tried once to warn her family about all this, didn't even try to get her granddaughter. I know that she tried to call her, tried to contact her, but she knows where she is. It's not a big town. She knows there's a dance going on. Go to the dance if you really want to get her. And now she's just apparently driving around just some random street hoping to just come across Michael. Not even considering one time that he might, just might, go back to the same fucking neighborhood he went to the first time. Meanwhile, back with Vicky, her boyfriend has stopped by for a little action.
I saw someone in the hallway standing outside my door.
They're interrupted by Julian, who hears something in his room. Vicky heads out to check it while her boyfriend, Red Herrings, with a motorcycle in the garage. This leads to absolutely nothing. It's just supposed to be a bait and switch for this scene. Okay. I get Michael is a, you know, sneaky dude. You know, he sneaks around. He's silent. You know, all that sort of thing. But how did he get in there? Why did he get in there? I hate this kid so much. Everything that he does, every word that he says, every action is just meant to just take you completely out of the movie and drain any tension that might exist. Let's compare to the original Halloween. When the shit went down, Tommy and Lindsay behaved like you would expect two kids to react to a masked killering someone in their presence. This kid, on the other hand, sees his babysitter getting attacked and just reacts like this.
Help! Julian! I'm looking for help!
The crowd I saw this movie with thought that this kid was just the funniest thing ever. I saw this movie with idiots. The police are called to the scene and Lori is right behind them and scares the trick-or-treaters away, while the sheriff goes inside to confront Michael. Hawkins finds Michael as well as two references to the first movie. Who is that for? I get that they're references to kills that Michael did in the first movie, but who's that for? Who's that benefit? Seriously, and the logic of this movie is Michael just recreating these kills for himself to taunt the cops? Does Michael know that he's in a movie? Does he have like some sort of fourth wall breaking powers or something? There are just so many questions. So many questions. Lori comes across Michael outside and is able to get a shot on him before he just disappears. This happens just so much. Where is he going? How is he disappearing like this? It's been established. We've seen him. He just walks so slow. It's never established that he took a car. He's just blending into nothing. I mean, he's a very tall man with a white mask. That sticks out. The cops show up and we are reintroduced to Dr. Sartain.
Maurice Strode, meet Dr. Sartain.
I'm Michael's doctor, Ranveer Sartain.
Oh, you're the new Loomis.
Pointing out your shitty writing doesn't make it any less shitty.
That I pray every night that he would escape.
Well, that was a dumb thing to pray for.
It sure was. Meanwhile, Allison and nice guy McGee are walking home.
You deserve better. Allison, you're the coolest, you're the prettiest, and you're the nicest girl in school. And if anyone doesn't appreciate that, they're a crazy person.
Jesus, I know exactly where this is going.
You deserve better, right?
What the fuck?
You're not with Cameron anymore.
That does not mean I want to be with you.
Oh, God. This is really cringe as fuck to me, just personally, but I don't know. Hopefully they'll do something. We'll be able to, you know, make it up somehow for that little mistake, you know, redeem himself somehow later in the movie.
Like, please! Help me! Help me! Help me! Please help me!
Wait a minute! So, the guy who cheats on his girl in front of everybody and dunks his girlfriend's phone into cheese, he just gets off scot-free. But the guy who goes in for one drunk kiss, which I'm not defending, I'm not saying that was a good thing. No. But he goes in for one drunk kiss, You know, one stupid, you know, little thing done by a teenager that I'm sure we've all done at some time before, and he deserves to just get killed brutally? I feel just personally insulted by this movie. This movie is insulting me personally. Michael pursues Allison, but she is soon picked up by Hawkins and Sartain.
Look! It's him!
Here we go. Brace yourselves.
Hawkins, maybe calm down a little bit. I know Ben Tramer survived in this timeline, but you don't want to repeat that. And there goes Ben Tramer Jr. But luckily, that was actually Michael that he hit. Seems it was easy enough to kill off Michael like this. Didn't even get a last confrontation with Laurie. Weird decision by the screenwriters.
Step away. Yeah!
What? Oh, okay, that's fine. It's certainly a way to go. It does feel a little bit like the writers kind of wrote themselves into a hole with the whole, you know, running him down thing and just had to think of a way to get him out of it. But it's different. You know, at least it's different for this. I mean, it's a trope that's kind of been done before, you know, with the scientist, you know, being on the side of the killer and what have you. But, you know, it's different. It's something. You know, it's a little late in the movie, but let's at least see where it goes. I hate this movie so fucking much. I get what they're going for here, but it's always stupid. A supposedly smart guy who becomes super obsessed with a killer, which eventually kills him. This is a played out trope which I have never liked. Sartain thinks this Michael is some kind of superior being or some shit. But all it resulted in him is getting us right back to square one and killing off a character who was barely in the movie in the first place. Cool head smash, though. As Allison runs aimlessly through the woods, Laurie and her family hold up in her stronghold. Wait, how did the police car show up? This compound has a very prominent gate that can only be opened by Laurie. How did it get in?
Any word?
You know what? It's fine. This seems like a trap, and cops don't normally just show up and creepily just sit there. But he'll be fine. After all, he is the strongest man in the world. I guess everything from my childhood is a lie. The time has finally come. Laurie shot him a bit before, but now Laurie and Michael will have their confrontation 40 years in the making. That seems like a design flaw when building this house. Luckily, Laurie remembers that she has a gun and is able to shoot off a few of Michael's fingers. Laurie turns on the floodlights, which causes Michael to disappear again, but then comes back immediately after to open the front door. Laurie, for some reason, leaves the safety of the basement to go after Michael. There is one point of entry! Let him come to you! But if she didn't come up, then we wouldn't have callbacks like this. And this. See, because those are things that happen in the first movie, you see. Those are references or callbacks. It's amazing this movie needed three screenwriters just to pad this movie out with these references and callbacks and nothing else. All right, this movie is almost over, so let's hurry up and power through this. Allison coincidentally shows up and joins her mom in the basement. But here comes Michael.
Help us! I can't do it! I'm sorry, I can't do it!
Gotcha. Happy Halloween, Michael.
You know, when all was said and done, Michael seems pretty easy to take down. Why is he such a threat? But Michael's not done yet. Yeah, Allison, run. Don't grab that knife and help us or anything. It's just so lazy that these women just become incompetent when the movie narratively needs them to be. Michael is finally subdued and trapped in the basement.
Okay, it's not a cage, baby. It's a trap.
Traps can also be cages. What the fuck does that line mean? And we end our movie with Michael trapped in the basement of a burning house, the fire of which started in that basement and spread to an alarming degree, finally ending the evil of the shape once and for all. Yeah, I know. There are two more sequels being planned for this, and filming just wrapped up on one of them, and if anything is in indication of this from the news that's been coming out, it's going to be filled with a lot more of the same, just references and callbacks and cameos and We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Halloween is such an unnecessary sequel. Clearly made purely for money with no story in mind and nothing to say. It has nothing original to say about the genre, about Halloween in general. It barely touches on Laurie's PTSD. I thought when I originally saw this movie, you know, I was getting hyped about it because it made it seem like there were certain interviews that it made it seem as though Laurie's PTSD was going to be like a big thing in this movie. Like it was going to be explored a lot more deeply. But in reality, it makes up maybe like one or two scenes and is never addressed again. And at the end, Laurie is just, you know, proven right. And she's proven that it was right that she did all this. And she was right all along. And she's perfectly competent of taking down Michael. I don't want to say by herself, but, you know, pretty well. This is by far, like I said, a pointless sequel. That's dumb, and I can't believe it did so well. I assume just everyone was just clamoring for more Halloween, and I'm hoping that people will see that these two sequels are as unnecessary as this one, and hopefully those will bomb. While I do plan on covering those other two sequels in reviews just like this, I have no plans whatsoever to see any of these in theaters. Well, that was my review of Halloween 2018. I hope you all enjoyed it, and I am sorry again that this was late, but I wanted to make sure that it was the best that it could be given the circumstances. I do promise, I know I promise this a lot, but I promise I will try to, you know, try to keep it up, you know, try to make it so that I can, you know, write faster and edit better, not just for this, but all my other content, which I promise is coming out. I want to appreciate all of your patience while I do all of this. I know that most people come to this channel for the light novel audiobooks, less for the reviews, but I am trying to put a little bit more effort into this, and I do appreciate anyone who takes the time to watch one of these reviews all the way through. I want to thank each and every one of you for watching once again. I want to thank you for liking and commenting and, of course, subscribing for more content. I hope you had just a fantastic Halloween whenever you're watching this. And whenever you're watching this, I do hope that you have a great day and just have a great day. Do something to have a great day. I really hope that this helped you have a great day. That's one of the reasons that I do this, is just to, you know, get my face out there and just to entertain people. So I hope I was able to do that for you, even though, again, it was a little bit late. And now I'm rambling, but again, it's the outro and nobody watches these anyway. So once again, this is The One Nerd, and that was just my opinion. Have a good one.